To load. Okay, I think we're live now. All right, guys, thank you very much for everyone who's here joining us live today. Thanks to everyone who's watching. We have a great show for you today. This is obviously an issue that has been discussed and debated at Nauseam, and there's often a lot of conjecture and not a lot of evidence that is used to discuss this problem. And often this is a problem that is, or often this is a debate, the Aryan invasion or the Aryan debate in general, that uses one discipline or one facet of evidence to prove an entire theory or to prove an entire origins of a civilization and a people and a language. So to declutter that and to make sense of some of that, I have with me Shrikant Talagiri. Shrikant ji, welcome to the show.
Yeah. Hello.
So Shrikant ji, let's start from the very beginning. So let's maybe talk about the origins. So if you can tell us a little bit about how the whole invasion theory actually came to be. What did they base the whole invasion theory on? Why did they fixate so much on the 1500 BC time period? And then we'll move on towards the evolution of the theory.
Yeah. Well, actually, you know, if you go 400 years ago, no one in the whole world had any idea that there was such a thing as Aryan languages or an Aryan invasion of India and all. It all started, you know, when the Europeans came to India.
Yeah.
And they were accompanied by certain scholarly people who were struck by, you know, Panini's grammar. It was so perfect compared to the sort of childish sort of grammar that they used to learn in Latin and Greek.
Yeah.
So they were thrilled, and then they were more surprised because they saw every word in Sanskrit seemed to be related to some word in Greek and Latin. And as they went deeper, they found that it was related to practically all the languages of Europe.
Right.
Sanskrit was related to all the languages of Europe except Finnish, Hungarian, and a language called Basque, which is spoken in northern Spain.
Okay.
So except for these three languages, they found all were related, and then they found Persian and various other languages like Kurdish and Pashto, and all these languages were related to each other. On the other hand, certain other languages which came in between, like, you know, Arabic, Hebrew, Turkish, they were not related to these languages. And the languages of South India were also not related. And this started the concept of, you know, language family. First, they called these languages Aryan languages because the two oldest books, the Rig Veda and the Avesta, the writers of these books refer to themselves as Arya or Arya.
Yes.
And the word Iran itself is Aryana, that is the land of the Aryans. We also have the word Aryavart.
Wow.
So you see, from that they decided that these people were Aryans. Then, you know, after Hitler misused that word, they decided that it would be better to use a purely geographical term, and Indo-European, or the Germans use the word Indo-German.
Right.
Is the name for this language family. And after that, you know, studies have shown that all the languages of the world can be divided into different language families, like Dravidian and all that. In India, we have six language families, actually. Aryan or Indo-European is one. There's Dravidian, there's Austric, there's Andamanese, there's Sino-Tibetan, and there's Burushaski, which is spoken in Pak-occupied Kashmir. So this is how the whole thing started. Now, when they discovered it, you know, they were thrilled because they thought that India was, you know, the homeland from which their ancestors must have come. So in the very beginning, actually, it was an out of India theory to begin with.
Wow.
But then, and because, you know, they thought that Sanskrit is the mother of all our languages. But as they studied further, they realized that Sanskrit was not the mother. That even Sanskrit had many changes from the original language. Even the oldest Vedic had many changes from the original language. So then the linguists, you know, sat and using various methods, which, though they are not absolutely correct, but they are reasonably correct. I mean, they can be open to further correction.
You just froze up there for a second, but you're back.
Yeah, yeah. So, everyone except Russians are foreigners. And in fact, if you see the theory, you know, all the branches had left, seven branches had left, only five branches were remaining. And Russian is not among those five branches. So, which means that even the Russians came back into that area afterward. So, there is no one actually who is in that original homeland. So all are foreigners in their land, but nowhere else do you find this made an issue. Whereas in India, it became a very big political issue, you know,
yes.
Region-wise, North Indians versus South Indians, or even caste-wise, they decided that the so-called lower castes were actually original Indians who were, you know, conquered and subjugated by the invading Aryans. So it became a very big industry, political industry. So that is how the issue, you know, went on, becoming a very important one and, you know, vital one to our national identity.
Why was the period of 1500 so important? Like, they've changed the story multiple times. They've gone from, you know, we were talking just before, that they've gone from Aryan invasion, that there was this massive invasion, armies of millions came in and slaughtered the Dravidians. We found no proof of that. So eventually they moved on to, okay, no, there was no invasion. There was actually a migration of people. So they've changed the story. But in the story, one constant is that they came in 1500. So why is that time period so important?
That date is very important to them, somewhere in the middle between 2000 and 1000 BC. Yes.
And you mentioned your book as well, right? That period is very important to understand.
Yeah, that's because, you know, we have recorded evidence from Ashoka's pillars in 300 BC. And before that, there are even Greek, Chinese and Persian records. All those records show that the whole of North India, right up to Bihar and Bengal, was speaking Indo-European languages at that time. So, you know, they can't have them entering India at that time because they were already established languages in North India at that time. So, and, you know, the Vedic literature, which is before the Buddhist age, you know, Buddha was dated at 600. And before him, the entire stream of Vedic literature came into being. Now, the Vedic literature is not some, you know, one book which is composed in one day. It consists of many layers of texts. You know, first are the Vedic Samhitas, then come the Brahmanas, then the Aranyakas, then the Upanishads, then the Sutras. And all this whole stream of literature is pre-Buddhist. And the language is so different that it shows they belong to different eras, all these texts. Within the Rigveda itself, as I have shown, there is an old Rigveda and a new Rigveda. Then the language of the Atharvaveda changes more. Then the language of the Sutras, and it keeps on changing all the time. So this whole period has to be squeezed in as small a period, point of time, a period as possible. Now, from the opposite side, there is another compulsion. Because, you know, all these 12 branches were together in one homeland. So that homeland, from there, the Indo-Aryans left that homeland and entered India. Now, when did they leave that homeland? Now, they can't push that date far beyond after 3000 BC.
Okay.
Why? The reason is because in 3000 BC, you know, certain things happened. Like the wheeled cart came into existence. Copper started to be used. And all these languages have common words for copper and wheels and wheel carts, which means that when that invention came into being, all these 12 branches were staying in one area and they shared that word. You know, like if some new invention comes now, then it is possible that there'll be a different word in India and a different word in Europe. But if we are all staying together at one time, you know, we'll have a common word. Now, this shows that they had not yet separated the 12 branches. And those inventions came into being around 3000 BC. So they cannot separate the branches before 3000 BC.
Okay.
So there is that one edge, you have 600 BC, the date of the Buddha. And the other end, you have 3000 BC, the date of all those technical innovations. So you have to have them coming into India somewhere between these two dates.
Right.
So 2000 to 1000 BC is the central area period of time in which they have to bring them into India. That was the compulsion.
That was the compulsion, right. And they've been, you know, they've been different ways in which they have sought to prove that, you know, there was this migration, and this migration was the one that brought in Indian culture and Indian language that we see today. That was the migration that brought it in. What proof, if any, has been presented when it comes to their migration and their migration being the one that was that brought in Indian culture and Indian language? Was there any proof that's been presented of that?
Well, to begin with, there was no proof. They just, you know, arrived at that date by, as I said, a central point between 3000 and 600 BC.
Right.
But then what happened was, you know, that time when they set out this full theory, there was no Indus Valley civilization discovered. So that time, all their analysis of the Rigveda, you know, had, you know, very cultured and civilized Aryans entering into a land occupied by savages.
Right.
And then suddenly when they discovered the Indus Valley civilization, which went back to 3000 BC, then they all the interpretations took a complete U-turn. You know, then it was the Aryans who were nomads and the local people were highly civilized.
Right.
So they had to change all the interpretations. You know, if you see Shyam Benegal's serial, based on Nehru's book. So in that, you know, he has actually shown them, you know, dressed like Banjaras or something. The Aryans entering the Indus Valley cities, sitting on the road and hopping things and being like hooligans and all. So, you know, they all this was manufactured out of the changed perspective. And then what happened was, you know, that they had to say that that Indus civilization was not Aryan and it was replaced by this Aryan one.
Right.
The only thing is that, you know, and conveniently, you know, the Indus Valley civilization had started petering off after 1900 BC.
Mm.
So then they immediately made the connection that it petered off because these people replaced them. But then, you know, archaeologists, surprisingly, you know, are the ones who totally disagree with this theory.
Okay.
In fact, there is a book, you know, there was a conference in the USA and all the papers in that conference have been put together into a book which has been edited by Michael Witzel himself, who is the strongest supporter of the Aryan invasion theory.
Okay.
Now, that the papers presented in that conference were by linguists and archaeologists. Now, all the linguists claim that there was an Aryan invasion, whereas all the archaeologists who are all Westerners, they're not Indian archaeologists. All of them completely reject the theory. They say that archaeology simply does not support it. Because between around, say, 5000 BC or so, 4000, 5000 BC, and the late first millennium, that is, say, 400, 500 BC, there is no evidence of any change taking place in the local population of that area, the Indus Valley area.
Right.
So archaeology completely rejects this Aryan invasion theory. So then there was this conflict. And then finally, you know, in the 1990s, we started, I and many other people started analyzing the textual evidence, the archaeological evidence, and even the linguistic evidence, which few people had cared to study till then. And the result is that, you know, we find that everything is completely turned on its when you actually examine the evidence.
Yeah.
All the evidence shows that it was an Aryan, and in fact, it's even recorded, as I said, in the Rig Veda and the Puranas. It's not pure speculation or, you know, theory.
Yeah.
It's recorded history. So then, you know, there was a... They were stymied. See, none of them has dared to reply to any of the evidence that we have placed before them.
Yeah.
But yet they had to say something. So finally, they have all stopped discussing linguistics, archaeology, and textual this thing, which are the three fields which are really connected to this subject. They have completely abandoned these fields, or they just keep repeating things that they were saying 200 years ago. And they present new papers just repeating those things. So then they suddenly got the idea of this genetics.
Mm.
And, you know, originally also this Aryan theory was a racist kind of theory.
Yeah.
That, you know, the Aryans who came were tall, fair, blonde, and blue-eyed. And they had long, straight noses. While the local people were dark and, you know, snub-nosed.
Yeah. Like that.
So now there is a new kind of racism. This genetics, although it is a science, has been converted by these people, historians, or so-called pseudo-historian, into a, you know, a new racial, new form of racism. They try to, you know, put everything in the genetic terms and then have racist theories in that, all the while claiming that it is scientific and not racist.
Right.
So now they only concentrate on genetical arguments.
Yeah, that's the part that I find very interesting, because, you know, if you're looking at a problem that there is a lot of debate about, you're looking to conclusively settle a debate. The best way to conclusively settle a debate that's been raging for such a long time is to approach it from every possible perspective and see where all of those perspectives eventually lead. So every possible perspective means, okay, you're looking at genetics, fantastic, let's look at genetics. You're looking at linguistics also. You're looking at archaeological evidence also. It's strange to me that in every other historical field, whenever we're talking about any other historical debate, we look at linguistic and archaeological evidence. But in India, for the Aryan invasion, archaeological and linguistic evidence is not allowed. Like, I find that to be a very silly thing to do. And before we actually dive a little bit more into it, you know, I want to discuss Tony Joseph's, some of his arguments, and then wrap up our discussion into sort of looking at those arguments a little bit as well, because your book is called Genetics and the Aryan Debate, which is Early Indians, Tony Joseph's Latest Assault. So your book is very specifically, even like in the title, it's very specifically aimed at answering some of the assertions that Tony Joseph has made. And why did you want to, you know, answer Tony Joseph in particular?
Yeah, because, you know, see, up till now, the debate was on the in the fields of linguistics, archaeology and textual. And we had answered the whole thing, means we had actually won the case, actually, though not in practical terms, because, you know, they control all the academia, the media, everything. But the thing is, you know, that now they started this genetical thing, but it was in the form of small articles here and there, and there was no sense in answering them. But for the first time, you know, they Tony Joseph, who was their spokesperson in the Hindu all these years, last few years, he put the whole thing into a book and he presented it as the final evidence. And the thing was, you know, that because he has presented it, and if you see the internet, for example, you'll see that they have given maximum publicity to him. Practically crores of, literally more than a crore references are there to his book. This, that means they were, that has become their main arguing point.
That's become the standard from which they argue now. Yeah.
So it was necessary to answer that. And the thing is that he has brought it all in one book. So it is easy to answer than this thing. So I have taken up every possible point made by him and answered it.
Right.
If there is any point I have left out, I will be happy to know about it.
There is a super chat from Right Is Always Right. Thank you very much for the super chat. And he's saying, Shrikant ji, that he's already bought your book and he has other books of yours as well. So he just wanted to let us know. So thanks very much for taking the book. Let's look at some of Tony Joseph's argument. There's a Tony Joseph video. I don't know if you've seen it. It's floating around on the internet. There's an online organization called The Quint. They did a video with Tony Joseph. They were promoting him quite heavily.
Yeah.
Where, you know, Tony Joseph starts off that video in a very smart way. You know, he starts the discussion of this whole Aryan invasion in a way that it's he starts from a position that's impossible to disagree with. So immediately he gets a lot of people on board because he says that, well, you know, nobody's pure. There's no such thing as a pure race or a pure caste or pure people in India. And nobody's going to disagree with that. That's the smart thing about what he says. Is nobody, of course, nobody believes that there is a pure caste or a pure race in India. So immediately he's got a lot of people on board. And then he brings out that argument. I think we discussed it previously as well offline, Shrikanji, that the Indian population is like a pizza. You know, the out of Africa people first came, then the West Asian settlers came, then the Harappans came, and, you know, then the Aryans came and all of that stuff he talks about. But while talking about all of that stuff, there is he does make one small distinction. I don't know if you've seen in the video that he makes one small distinction that all he says all of Vedic culture did not come from outside. Some of it originated in India. But he doesn't explain at any point during the video. And I want to know from you if he explains during the book that he wrote how or in any way that the Aryans, the people that came in, brought certain languages or the Indian culture with them. Does he explain how they brought it with them?
No, actually, all he does is, as I said, he concentrates on that 2000 to 1000 period.
Okay.
Now, he claims that this report last year by Reich and others, that has proved that people from the steppe entered India. And then they spread out all over India so that their genes, their DNA is now found among all Indians, all sections of Indians. That is his claim. Now, I have shown in one chapter how even that report does not really confirm what he says about that time period and everything. But even then, I have not disputed that. Let some geneticists dispute that. I have said, okay, people came from the steppe between 2001 and 1000 and they mixed everywhere among all the forms of Indian. But that does not explain that they brought the Aryan languages with them. Like all Indians have different ancestries, mixture of many different ancestries. As he says and as we all agree, no one is pure. All of us have different ancestries. But how can you say which of those ancestries brought which language?
Yes.
That ancestries don't tell us, you know, genes don't tell us the language.
Yes.
For example, he tells us that there is a genetic signature of the Aryans. That is R1A1. And I know there are many other people from our side also who pick up that same argument and then they try to show, you know, that R1A1 is actually Indian and all that sort of thing. But my point is that whether it is Indian or foreign, it really does not matter because no one claims, you know, that from the moment of the Big Bang, or from the moment that God created the world, you know, that Aryan languages have been spoken in India from that point of time. No, they must have started at some time. People must have come from outside. All kinds of things have taken place. No one is pure.
Yeah.
That is why I have said, you know, for example, if you take my own DNA, it is possible you will find that it's a mixture of Maori, Hottentot, Eskimo, Arab, Step, anything is possible. What difference does that make? The question is that the language that I speak and the family to which it belonged, did that come from outside with any of those DNA streams? No one can prove that. Now, you know, this R1A1 signature, which he calls the genetic signature of Indo-European people. Now, what he does now, and then he even tries to bring in caste into it. You know, he says that Brahmins everywhere have a higher this thing. And so he
directly claims that Brahmins, there, you know, Brahmins are the descendants
Hindu,
of the Aryans.
Hindu texts, everything. Yeah. But the thing is, you know, that what he does not tell and what people will not bother to examine is that R1A1, you find it in the south among the Kota tribes who are pure Dravidian.
Right.
Caste-wise, culture-wise, everything. They have it 23% is R1A1. Then if you see the Chenchu tribes, it's 26%. If you see the Manipuri people, Meitei, who speak Sino-Tibetan languages, it is above 50%.
Wow.
If you see the Shamma tribes of Kuwait, okay, that is also 46 or something percent. They are Arab-speaking. If you see the Ashkenazi Levites, who are one of the two priestly classes of Jews in Israel, they have it 52%. So all these people, you know, have very high percentage. They are none of them Aryan under any circumstance. And at the same time, you know, Zoroastrians or Iranians. The Zoroastrians are also, you know, very endogamous. They try not to mix with others and all that. So they should, and they consider themselves pure Aryans. They represent the Avesta, which is a very Aryan text. And their percentage is less than 20%. Germans, you know, Hitler considered himself a pure Aryan. The percent of R1A1 in Germans is less than 20%. It's 17 or something. In Britishers, it is 11%.
Yeah.
So suppose we were to bring 10 samples without telling him where we have got those samples from, any geneticist. If we give them, say, 20 samples from the Chenchu, 20 from the Kota tribe, 20 from the Manipuris, 20 from the Shamma tribes of Kuwait, 20 from the Ashkenazi Levites of Israel, 20 from Germans, 20 from Britishers, 20 from Zoroastrians. Would they be able to, without knowing where it has come from, would they be able to tell us which of those are speakers of Indo-European languages, which are not? You see, they cannot, because R1A1 does not show it. They would end up with wrong results. So that is the proof. Once you know, you take something and then you try to squeeze out some evidence from it. That is not the thing. But just by examining the DNA, you can tell us the language of the person. That would be proof.
Right. You hit upon something very, very profound, I think, in my opinion, because I think there's been among some of the people that have been, you know, fighting the or speaking out against or trying to disprove the Aryan invasion theory, there's been a certain dogmaticism in their own heads as well, where they feel like they need to prove that every single person living in India originated in India. You know what I mean? They have this idea that we need to prove that every single bit of genetics or people in India, their genetics originated from India. And that's not the important part. You know, that's not important at all. You know, let's say that some people came down from the steppes in whatever 1500 BC came and settled in India. But that's not the only time, Shrikanthji, that people have come from outside and settled in India.
Yeah.
The Iranians have done it. The Greeks have done it. The Shaks have done it. The Kushans have done it. So many people have done it. So many people have come from outside, came to India, settled in India. But the important thing has always been that they have all assimilated into the Indian culture and the Indian languages that already existed in the Indian subcontinent. That's been the important part, right? That's the part that they're missing.
Yeah, that is the key point. No, what they are claiming is that the culture which we would normally consider as the classical Indian culture, the Vedic Sanskrit culture, that has come from outside. That is their theory. As I said, even if this were true, it would not matter because it is thousands of years old. Whereas, you know, all the cultures of Europe, the German, British, Greek, all would also be invader cultures like that.
Right.
So it would not really matter. But nevertheless, that is their main reason for trying to show it. So that is the question, you know, whether it is not whether we have come from outside, who has how much ancestry of from foreign sources. The question is whether this, the whole thing, as I said, is nothing but a discussion of language. You know, there is this Indo-European language family. It has 12 branches. All those 12 branches, you know, evolved together in one place, which was the original homeland. From there, they split into 12 dialects, and those dialects shifted and moved over all this entire region from Iceland and Britain to Sri Lanka.
Yes.
That is history. So the only question is, which is that area in which these 12 branches is developed and then spread out?
Yes.
That is the only question. It has nothing to do with who those people are, whether they are black or white, whether they are blonde or black haired, whether they are tall or short, whether they have flat noses or sharp noses, nothing. What DNA they have, whether they have R1, A1, or they have K or P or M, none of that is really the important thing. And the you can find out about this, like, for example, I have given the example of chess.
Yes.
You know, anything where it originates, it is linguistics and archaeology and textual references. These are the three things which, like, linguistically we know that chess originated in India because it's called, you know, Chaturang in Sanskrit. The Vietnamese name is Choi Trang.
Hmm.
The Mongolian name is Shatara. The Arabic name is Shatranj. All these words are derived from Chaturang. So linguistically, you know, it went out from India. Textually, you know, because all these countries record that it went out from India.
Right.
And archaeologically, you have the oldest evidence of chess in India. So, you know, these are the three fields in which you can find out about historical origins. Genetics has nothing to do with it.
Yeah.
Buddhism also went out from India. You know it from language, you know it from texts, you know it from archaeology.
Yeah, how will you know from genetics?
Genetics can tell us nothing about any of these things.
That's a very good point. The Buddhism example is a very good point to sort of what you're talking, that,
yeah,
you know, Buddhism went out from India. We know, we very clearly know, and everybody who knows anything about Buddhism knows that it came out from India. But how do we know that? We know that from linguistic and archaeological sources.
Yeah.
That's a very good point that you made. And another thing, you know, that you were also talking, I think there was in, it was in the book or either in one of your interviews, you were talking about how, you know, in archaeological terms as well. So there's linguistic terms where you're talking about Chaturanga and Shatranj. There are archaeological examples as well. I think you mentioned where there were elephant and peacock motifs in Western Asia, where there's no elephants or peacocks. So they obviously, those motifs have come from somewhere, or people have brought them, and they have this civilizational memory of some animals that they used to have back in the homeland. So there's that
and
also.
Elephants and peacocks are found in India and Southeast Asia. They're not found further west.
Yes.
So if you find them west, they must have gone from here only.
Yes.
There's no this thing.
Yeah.
There
exactly.
can't be two opinions about that.
Yeah. Yeah. Another point that this guy, the Tony Joseph makes is, you know, it was the Aryans that came from outside, and then their descendants became the Brahmins. And then these Brahmin descendants of the Aryans, they created the caste system about 1,000 years after the Aryans came and settled.
Yeah.
And when somebody asked them, well, why didn't they bring the caste system with them? I mean, if they brought this entire culture with themselves, they brought this entire culture, they brought the Rig Vedas, they brought everything with them, why did they not bring the caste system? Why did the caste system evolve 1,000 years later? To that question, he says, oh, because there were liberal Aryans and then there were conservative Aryans. And the liberal Aryans said, we don't want a caste system. And the conservative Aryans said, we want a caste system. So suddenly, 1,000 years later, they decided, okay, let's have a caste system now. The conservative
but
Aryans
But where did
he
get all this information from? I mean, did he get some telepathic or did he get prophetic dreams or something? I mean, there should be records. No, you can't sit down and make up your own theories like this.
Yeah, that's the part that I was going to ask you, that what do you think he's basing this on? Like this entire massive conjecture, what is this on?
See, actually, there was some report which came some few years ago in 1913 or something. And I have quoted that in the book, and he has quoted it, which says that, you know, that the caste system was not there before, say, 2000 years before.
Mm.
Before 2000 years. It came into being in 100 BCE or 100 CE, between that period. Long, long after the Aryans are supposed to have come into India. So what he claims is that till then, all the Aryans and non-Aryans were mixing freely. Then at that point of the time, you know, that he's trying to bring it bring the question of Brahminism into it.
Yes.
He claims that the Brahmins suddenly brought the shutters down I don't know how they managed to do it in those technologically inferior times, but all over India, in every corner, mountain top, jungle, everywhere, they managed to, you know, suddenly put the shutters down on caste mixing. And after that, castes have been studied. Now, that report, you know, if you take it logically, it means that it has no connection with Aryans, because Aryans had mixed for 1,000 years and there were no Aryans left. Everyone was a mixture of Aryans and non-Aryans. Yes. So how do you then after, so he can't reject that since he's talking about genetics. So he accepts that. He says, yes, it has no connection with the Aryan theory. And then, you know, he twists and turns everything. And suddenly before you know what, yes, the Brahmins and Hindus are responsible for it. So the main target is Brahmins and Hindus. Hinduism, rather.
Yes.
So, but what is the logic then? If you want to really connect it with some kind of ethnic, then connect it with ethnic people who had entered India at around that time. Maybe the Huns, the Mao, they must have introduced the Arya. If you want it to have been introduced by some section of people, then connect it with people who entered India at that time.
Right.
If the people had mixed so much, then how did they, you know, form castes which were based on the Aryan DNA in them? Did they check everyone's DNA and then form these castes? What is the logic?
How did they find out who is a, you know, how do you figure out who is a pure Aryan after 1,000 years of mixing?
Yeah. And today, even recent reports are that the Roars and the Jats have the highest steppe blood. Now, they are not Brahmins. So, what is the logic?
Yeah. It is interesting because you can twist it, right? The argument that Tony is making, you can twist it. You can say, okay, now we have evidence that Indian culture and Indian language existed before the Aryans came to India, or because whatever migration came to India. Migration happened. And then after that, you know, these so-called Aryans started setting up the caste system or whatever. So is you can twist it around back on him, that is Indian culture to blame for it, or are the outsiders to blame for it? Indian culture existed before. You know what I mean? You can turn it back around on him.
No, the point is that he claims that there was an Indian culture before, but it was not, the people were not speaking Aryan or Indo-European languages. They started that after, after the Aryan invasion in 1500 BC.
Right.
So the point is, you know, that is why I say, you know, that we owe a very great debt to two people. One is Ashoka. Because of his pillars in 300 BC, you know, which shows, and then of course the Greek and Persian records are there and Chinese records. So we know that there were Aryans all over North India. Otherwise, you know, they would have said that Aryans entered India 2000 years ago. They could have said that, but they can't, because there is recorded evidence. The second recorded evidence, which was discovered just at the beginning of the last century, was the Mitanni records. And the Mitanni records are the record the names of Mitanni kings who had Vedic names, not just Indian or Sanskrit name, but purely Vedic names. And those Vedic names are found right from 1500 BC, before 1500 BC. And there is evidence that those Mitanni people, their ancestors were there in West Asia even 300 years before that.
Okay.
Say, so how can they have had Vedic names even before the Aryans entered India and composed the Vedas?
Yeah.
So then when you see this, that is the importance of the old Rig Veda and the new Rig Veda. Because if they had, you know, left from before the Aryans entered India, if the Mitanni people had entered West Asia, they would have had a culture which was pre-Vedic.
Yes.
Or it would have been something which you would find traces of it in the old Rig Veda. However, the entire culture is common with the new Rig Veda and totally missing in the old Rig Veda.
Right.
And then if you say, you know, the old Rig Veda must be outside India, but no, it isn't. It is in fact even further inside India. It is in Haryana and Uttar Pradesh. It is not even in Punjab or Afghanistan.
Right.
In fact, those areas enter into the picture in those books only after Sudas, as I told you, starts his conquest westwards, which is described in the Rig Veda.
Right. So, how can we tell that the old Rig Veda was sort of composed in the areas of Haryana and Uttar Pradesh, and the new Rig Veda was composed in the areas of the Punjab? Because is it because of the names of rivers and places in Haryana and Uttar Pradesh? Is that why?
Rivers, places, mountains, lakes, and animals. Like, for example, elephant, the peacock, the spotted deer, the bull, buffalo, wild buffalo, and the gaur, the Indian bison. These are five animals which are named throughout the Rig Veda. You find them in all the 10 books of the Rig Veda. Whereas the northwestern animals like the Bactrian camel, the goat, sheep, you know, even today the original areas of these are Kashmir, yes, Afghanistan, western Pakistan and all that. So goat, sheep, camels and all these western animals, and those are names which are found in common with the Avesta. Remember this, all the same name, you know, like Ushtra and in the Rigveda, Ushtra in the Avesta. So these Indo-Iranian names are found only in the new Rigveda. They are not found in the old Rigveda of animals also.
Wow.
Whereas the Indian animals, which are purely found in India, you see, they are not found beyond India in Afghanistan and all that. They are found in the interior of India. They are found throughout the Rigveda.
Interesting.
And it's without a single exception. You know, we are not saying, see, the old Rigveda has 70 words and they have 30 words, so old Rigveda has more or something. It's not like that. New Rigveda has zero and old Rigveda has hundreds and thousands. So it's not more versus less. It's zero versus a huge number. That is the main point.
You often mention that the Avesta is an important, you know, piece of the puzzle in terms of the whole genetic and the Aryan invasion stuff as well.
Yeah.
Why do you think the Avesta is relevant?
The Avesta is relevant because that is the oldest text next to the Rigveda. That is the second oldest Indo-European text anywhere in the world. And moreover, it is important because it is linked to the Rigveda. You know, the language is so similar that some people have, you know, taken an Avestan verse and then, you know, replacing the sounds with the equivalent Rigvedic sound, like H in the Avesta becomes S in the Rigveda. So you just make those replacements and you get what looks like a purely Rigvedic verse.
Wow.
That is the extent of similarity between the Rigveda and the Avesta. And, you know, their theory has always been that there was an Indo-European stage in South Russia. Then there was an Indo-Iranian stage after these two branches had separated from the other 10 and they had come into Central Asia.
Okay.
And then there is an Indo-Aryan stage after these people entered India. Now, I have given one example of a word, you know, there is the word for night.
Yes.
You know, there is the word Nakt, which you find in the old Rigveda. You do not find the word Ratri at all in the old Rigveda. It is a new word.
Okay.
You find Nakt. And Nakt is related to the words in every single other branch.
Yeah, in German, it's pretty much the same, exact. In German, yeah, it's Nakt.
Yeah, Nakt. It's in the Avesta, although it is not the common word, it is there once as Nakt.
Okay.
It is there in Latin, it is there in Greek, it is there in Hittite, in Tocharian, in Russian, Lithuanian, all the languages. Whereas they don't have the word Ratri. That is the Indo-European word.
Okay.
But in the Avesta also, you know, that word has already become lost. It is not there in the Avesta. So it represents, you see, the new Rigveda. It has another word, which is also found in the Rigveda, throughout the Rigveda, you know. In Rigveda, there is a second word for night, which is Kshap. Kshap. It is found in the Avesta. That is the common word in the Avesta, Kshap. From which you get the modern Persian word Shab. Shab, you know, Shabakhair and
yes,
Shabnam and all that, night. It is a modern Persian word for night, and it is there in the Avesta. And it is not found in the other branches outside India, except these two. And then you have Ratri, which is found only in Indian languages, modern Indian languages. So all these three stages are represented in the Rigveda, because, you know, all these three stages, Indo-European, Indo-Iranian and Indo-Aryan, took place in India itself. So you have all these three stages of that word in India.
And is there any archaeological or linguistic evidence in Russia, southern Russia, or
yeah,
some sort of a steppe homeland?
Yeah. No, because what can you find until you find some, like, you know, they have tried, they found those Kurgan mounds there.
Yeah.
Some and they tried to say they were the Proto-Indo-Europeans. And then what are the distinct arguments? Those people used boats. The Indo-Europeans also used boats, so they were Indo-European. But then everyone uses boats, the Red Indians, the Africans, the Chinese, everyone used boats.
Yeah.
How can you say they were Indo-Europeans and that count?
Yeah.
Until you find the written records, you cannot say what language they spoke.
Yeah, that's true. The another argument that I feel like people like Tony Joseph and a lot of other these proponents of the Aryan invasion theory, they tend to make is that, well, look at the differences that exist between certain languages in India and certain other languages in India. Like, look at Indo-European languages, look at these... look at Tamil, for example. Tamil is different. It's a different family of languages. That clearly proves that the people of Tamil Nadu and the Tamil speakers are the original speakers and the original residents, and these foreigners came out of here and drove them away. What do you say to that assertion?
See, they are the original speakers of South India, not of the whole of India. You know, below the Vindhyas, obviously they were the original people. Above the Vindhyas were the Indo-Europeans. And the Puranas tell us, you know, which tribes were there spread out all over North India. And they name five main tribes, which they call the lunar tribes. The Puru, Anu, Druyu, Turvasu and Yadu. And there is another tribe to the far east that they call the Ikshvakus, who are in Bihar and eastern UP.
Yes.
And they give us the geographical locations of all these tribes, you know. And it is the Puru or the Vedic Aryans who occupied the Vedic areas which are described in the old Rig Veda. And then, you know, they expanded westwards into the area of the Anus and Druhus, who are the 11 branches which migrated out of India from the west, who are to the west of India, in the northwestern parts. So there is no question that whoever was, like the Andamanese people were always there in the Andaman Islands.
Yeah.
Always, I don't mean again, as I said, not from the time of the Big Bang, but they were there in historical, reasonably historical times.
So with, you know, the point that you made about different people that existed, you know, it really makes you think that, you know, even though there are these common strains of Indian culture and Indian civilization that run through the entirety of India, that run through every community and every people in India, but still there are regional disparities and regional idiosyncrasies in people, in culture, in language, that gives their language a certain flavor, that gives their culture a certain flavor. You know, you even if you look at somebody who's from Punjab, for example, a Punjabi Hindu has a very different culture and lifestyle from even like a Assamese Hindu, very different.
Yeah.
A Bihari Hindu, like myself, has a very different lifestyle, culture, you know, certain religious practices as compared to a Kannada Hindu, for example.
Yeah.
Like for in Bihar and Eastern UP, they celebrate this old, very, very old festival called Chhat.
Yeah.
Now, Chhat is a very, it has those elements of very ancient Rig Vedic practices, because there's no mandir involved. There's no, you know, murti involved, nothing like that.
Yeah.
Chhat Puja is about, you know, you're praying to the upcoming sun. That's what you're praying to. So it's a very Rig Vedic practice almost in that way, the Chhat Puja. So that is very different from the Durga Puja that they do in Bengal. So even in such a small area, there are so many cultural discrepancies, right?
Yeah. No, they are not discrepancies. They are the richness of a culture. We should be proud that we have such a wide variety.
Yes.
Why should we think that difference means, you know, enmity or hostility?
Yes.
It's something to be proud of. In fact, I have always said, you know, that India represents the world in microcosm. That is what we should be proud of. You know, out of, as I said, out of around, say, roughly 19, there may be more, but 19 language families in the world, we have six. There are three races in the world, you know, as per old classification, you know, Mongoloid, Caucasoid and Negroid. India is the only area in the world which has all three native to it. Andamanese Islanders are, we should be proud of it that we have this variety. As I wrote in one this thing, you know, the Andaman Islanders are about to become extinct. We should consider it a great tragedy for Indian culture, because one of our three races, that is one third of our racial culture, because that is also part of our culture, is dying out.
Yes.
One sixth of our linguistic culture is dying out. Every plant, animal species, every musical instrument, every architectural style which becomes extinct. We are becoming the poorer by it.
Yes.
And everything in my article, our Indian, in my video talk on the YouTube, our Indian tribals, Hindus. In the end, I have shown a Toda hut. Have you ever seen it? That, why don't we realize that is also something, an architectural style we should be very proud of.
Yes.
So you see, everyone, whether whichever corner of India he is from, he should feel proud of the culture of the opposite corner of India as much as his own culture. So why should, if it is different, all the more reason for us to be proud, you know?
Yes.
That, see, this is a rich culture. We are not one, you know, just cut out of one pattern. We have the widest variety and range. You know, the cold, if you see the Encyclopedia Britannica about India, they will tell us that outside the polar regions, the largest area under permanent ice and snow is in India.
Yes.
At the same time, if you see the hottest places on earth, They are also in India, you know.
Some of the wettest places on earth are also in India.
Yeah. Then if you see, there are areas in India which don't receive any rainfall at all. Then we have the wettest places in Assam. Why don't we feel proud that we have all this variety? Why do you want that everyone should be wearing one uniform? Like, you know, the Maoists all had people, all the Chinese wearing one kind of uniform. We have to be proud of this thing. And each of that is the thing, you know. And thankfully, this Tony Joseph himself has given us a reason. You know, what is it that connects the Andamanese people right up to all the other people of India, right up to the Bactrian area? It is this first Indian DNA, as he says. So he has given us the thing. Why we say we are different from the rest of the world? There, all of us are one.
Yes.
There may be differences. All those are part of our rich culture, and we should be proud of it.
That's
the thing. Is, you know, that even among our people, there are people, you know, who want this kind of strain. They want to say everything came from the Vedas. Then, you know, they'll try to derive things from that Vedas. You know, it is not. As I said, most of our aspects of Hinduism are not derived from the Vedas, because they are not derived from the culture of the Purus. You know, all our philosophical concepts came from the Ikshwakus, who were to the east in Bihar and eastern UP. Because see, where are the Upanishads? There, most of the discussions take place in the court of Janaka, who was in Videha.
Yes.
Where did Buddhism originate? In Bihar. Where did Jainism originate? In Bihar. Where was Charvaka? He was in the east. All the philosophical movements, whether it is Upanishads right up to atheism, or the atheism of Charvaka, they all originated in the east, all thinking processes, you know, philosophies. Whereas in the west, we have all our yajnas and rituals and all in Punjab. And where did the temple culture and all this, you know, palanquins and chariots and temples, idols, all those things? In the south, where did tantric rites originate? In Bengal and the east.
Yes.
And all these are Indian, they are parts of an Indian thing. They did not, you know, come in a linear fashion from Vedic culture.
Yes.
They were always there. You know, the Jains have a tradition that Mahavir was something 26th or something Tirthankara. He was not the first one.
Oh,
so
wow.
It is true. So you see, their culture also, non-Vedic culture in the east also went far and back into the past. But all of us are connected together. All of them belong to us. That is what we should remember.
That's true. I think the problem is that there was a bit of a fear among Indians and people, you know, under sort of duress from the whole Aryan invasion theory, where people were coming to Indians and telling that every little aspect of your culture comes from outside. So there was this, I feel like there was this panic among some certain people in India where they were like, all right, no, hang on. Everything actually comes from the Vedas, and this is how. But you're right in a way that, you know, there's the Vedas, and the Vedas, the culture of the Vedas, the people of the Vedas have mixed with the culture of the, you know, that you're talking about, that developed later with the Vedantas and the temples and all of these other philosophies. They're mixed in together to create this khichdi in a way that we call India, that we call
Indian
civilization.
Yeah, we need not call it a pizza, we can call it a khichdi.
Exactly. Tony Joseph calls it a pizza, we'll give it
khichdi, we'll
give it an Indian name.
We are proud of it.
Yeah, we're proud of our Indian origin khichdi, you know. So I think that's a fantastic way of looking at it, and that's where the evidence points to as well. And here's a question. There's actually a super chat here from D. Mohan. D. Mohan, thank you for the super chat. He's asking that there is overwhelming pressure from Western genetic studies and, you know, these Indologists supporting pro-Aryan theory. What can be done from our side to negate them, or to, you know, present a cogent genetic argument combined with linguistics and archaeology? And just to add to that as well, Srikanthji, you also said, you know, in your book, you also said that the problem isn't necessarily these Western Indologists. The problem tends to be Hindus, usually.
Yeah.
So
you see, we present a united front. You know, there is a theory. Remember, there is a ideological battle going on based on, you know, certain facts. What happened? The only question, remember this, the only question is, where did the Indo-European languages originate?
Yes.
Nothing else is the question. And this question has been answered by us so fully. The out of India theory explains it. We have actually ideologically won the battle, but practically we have lost it, because, you know, there are people battling from inside, you know, trying to pull the feet of this and, you know, push their own, you know, obsessions, like, you know, Vedas are eternal. People, you know, they don't see that I have proved the OIT from the Rig Veda. They see that I have, you know, committed some kind of blasphemy by finding historical characters in the Rig Veda. The Rig Veda is eternal. It is the word of which has always existed. by putting it names of kings and events in it, I have, you know, demeaned it. So that is the kind of attitude which is there among many people. Others, you know,
that's
they,
silly, right? That's silly. It's almost, so it's treating it like some kind of,
you know, who want to take things back. You know, the Ramayana took place 15,000 years ago and Mahabharata took place 8,000. You know, they think that large figures are more, but they are not logical, you know.
Yeah.
For let me say, for example, 2200 BC is the period when spoked wheel chariots were invented.
Okay.
Now, you know, the majority of people in India will insist that 3100 BC or so, and there are others who take it back thousands of years before that, is the date of the Mahabharata, 3100 BC. But there were no spoked wheel chariots in existence then. So what was the chariot which Krishna held in his arm when he pulled out the chariot and went to attack Bhishma, if you remember in the Mahabharata? What were the chariots these people were driving? It can't have taken place in 3100 BC because there were no spoked wheel chariots then. Suppose you have a story located in the 18th century where people are talking on mobiles. Will it seem natural? So, yeah. You know, certain things were invented at certain points of time and you can't place those events before that.
Yeah.
Of course, things have been added. Remember this, things have been added in texts like Ramayana and Mahabharata. For example, in the Ramayana, you find references to the Cholas, Pandyas, Cheras who were there only in, for, say, 5,500 BC.
Yeah.
But that is because, you know, there are interpolations in those texts where people kept on adding things. If you see the picture, Sampurna Ramayana, you'll see there is a scene in it, you know, after Sita has been kidnapped by Ravana. Then, you know, Rama is going sadly through the jungle and he sees a fruit and he opens it and he sees Sita in it. And that, we are told, is Sita Phal.
Yeah.
And there in Lanka, she opens the fruit and there it is Ram Phal because she sees Ram in it. But, you know, the Ram Phal and Sita Phal came from, were brought by the Portuguese from the Americas. They did not exist
really?
In India before. Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Now the filmmaker does not know that.
I didn't know
He's
that either.
Going by the name, going by those common names, you know, he decides that let's put that in the scene in the film. Now, you think future generations will take that as an authentic thing and say, yes, Ram saw Sita's image in the Sita Phal and Sita saw Ram's image in a Ram Phal. So, at every period of point of time when people interpolate things and add their own things, they add according to their own time.
Yes.
So, you cannot take it as original. On the other hand, the Rig Veda has been kept alive without changing even one syllable, even one tone. So it has no interpolations, or it has whatever interpolations are there or before 1500 BC. And even the Western scholars admit that there has been, I have quoted Witzel profusely in my book to that effect, that there is no, that Rig Veda is like a tape recording of that period.
Right.
No changes or no interpolations are there in it.
Right.
So you have to take it at its word.
Yeah.
And it is, you know, because every new thing you take out, like for example, things which were invented in 2200 BC, like the spoked wheels were invented in 2200 BC, you find them only in the new Rig Veda. You don't find them in the old Rig Veda.
Yeah.
Because the old Rig Veda goes far back beyond 2500 BC.
Yes.
Camels were domesticated and donkeys were domesticated around 2200 BC. You find them in the new Rig Veda. You don't find them in the old Rig Veda.
Oh, wow.
Then there are, as I said, there are thousands of name types which you find among the Mitanni and the Avesta Niranians. You find them only in the new Rig Veda. You don't find them in the old Rig Veda.
Yeah.
I gave the word example already of the word Nakt and Kshap, which are found throughout the Rig Veda, and Ratri, which is found only in the latest parts of the Rig Veda. After that, it is found hundreds of times in the Atharva Veda, and now it is the only common word.
Right.
So, you see, yeah.
Go ahead.
The Rig Veda is original. It is not, you can take it that it does not have any interpretations.
Yeah, I mean, even within the Rig Veda, you have these examples of, you know, the old Rig Veda and the new Rig Veda, where changes were, you know, certain changes were made, certain new ideas and new words were brought into the lexicon of the new Rig Veda. So even within the Veda, that these proponents, you know, these vested interests that you're talking about the Vedas being eternal and the Vedas being unchanging. Even within
they
the
don't
Vedas,
like it,
there have been such massive changes.
Yeah.
So what do we, when you say, you know, the problem is, the biggest problem and the biggest hurdle tends to be Hindus, what do you think needs to be done to address that problem?
Well, see, we have to face, I know that for this book also, I'll face plenty of trolling from the AIT supporters. Yes. But the thing is that I'll also face trolling from so-called Hindus who don't like the Aryan invasion theory. I'll face trolling from them also, because they won't like these things, you know, that I have dated the Veda, I have found an old and a new Rig Veda, I have found, historical evidence in the Rig Veda, all kinds of things, that I'm saying that the Vedic culture is not the ancestral culture, it is just the culture of one tribe settled in Haryana and western Uttar Pradesh, the Purus. So all these things they won't like, and that's why they will. So you see, we have to fight with the truth, only then we can win the battle. Right. We have to have the proper weapons. If we are fighting among ourselves, we can't. The opposition are united at least in their main scheme of things. We are not. That is the problem.
So how do they expect this problem to be solved if they say don't date the Rig Veda, don't find any historical evidence, don't find any empirical evidence in the Rig Veda, but still dispute or disprove the Aryan invasion? How do they expect to do that?
Well, they expect, I suppose they want us to adopt some Zakir Naik type of logic, you know. See, the Rig Veda says this, see, this text says this, so that is, that proves it. That's, you don't use a logic, just use quoting, you know, verse this, verse that from this book, and that proves everything. That is what they want.
Yeah, I find it very silly, because at the end of the day, you know, what would be your... To provide like a summary of the book, and we'll talk about the book in just a second, but to provide the summary of your book, you know, what would you say would be the biggest takeaway that people should be taking when they read this new book of yours?
Yeah, they have to realize, you know, see, what has happened is that the whole thing they should realize is only a question of language. For example, I have pointed out in that it is not even that religious, this thing, that Vedic, it's not a question of Indian and foreign, as I said. You know, like I have pointed out, like I have given an example in my book itself, that in our math in Shirali, for example, in Karnataka, we have a ritual called Dyutige Salam, of which one word Dyutige is borrowed from Kannada and one word is borrowed from Muslims, Salam. Then when a Maharashtrian person, for example, does religious fasting during the month of Shravan or something, he eats, you know, Sabudana Khichdi. Yeah. Now, you know, all these four items were brought by the Portuguese from America, you know, sapudana, groundnuts, chilies, and potatoes. All, none of them are Indian, and we are using them in a religious fast. Then I have pointed out in my analysis of the Rig Veda that the soma is not an Indian plant; it is a Central Asian plant, which, and the Vedic people borrowed that religious ritual from the Central Asians through the Iranians who were to their west.
Right.
Even the yajna, the main yajna ritual, the Rig Veda credits the Iranian priests, the Bhrigus, as being the one who imparted that knowledge to them of the Yajnas. So you see, even we are not claiming that nothing came from outside India, but there should be some logic. The only question is of the language. And since we have firstly proof that we have the, in the, as I said, in the Dasharatna battle, we have the names of all the five final branches, you know, Indo-Aryan, Iranian, Albanian, Greek, and Armenian. They are all there in this spot. They take part in this battle. And then the Rig Veda describes how they were, they migrated westwards. Before that, the Puranas mention even older traditions where the Druyus migrated northwards into Central Asia and migrated westwards from Central Asia. So the whole thing is described there. And another thing is that there is no way in which once you accept the Mitanni evidence, which shows that the ancestors of the Mitanni went from India sometime around 2500 BC, after 2500 BC. Because when you compare the evidence, there is no other conclusion you can reach. And the old Rig Veda is even older than that, and it is located deeper inside India. So that cannot fit in with a, any theory where, you know, all the 12 branches are in South Russia in 3000 BC. So that is the main thing. Firstly, people have to realize that this is only a linguistic question. It is not a question of religious elements. It is not a question of, certainly not a question of ethnic identities and DNA and genes and haplogroups. And secondly, what they must realize is that anyone who wants to promote the Aryan invasion theory in spite of all this, they will first have to disprove the evidence that I have given for the date of the Rig Veda, which goes back beyond 3000 BC. if they just ignore that and keep on bringing rubbish about, you know, haplogroups and genetic signatures and all, it won't do.
Because haplogroups are not proving either language or culture.
It can show neither. That some ancestors of us came from there. Okay, so they did.
Yeah.
But what they did was they came here and adopted this local culture. There's no proof that they brought this culture with them.
Yes. That's the important part at the end of the day. Yeah. I mean, if we had this argument already, we could have said to the British, when the British postulated this theory, we could have said to the British, well, the Aryans that you're telling us about, that, oh, before the Aryans also came and they colonized you, so let us colonize you with the same thing. We could have also told them, all right, maybe the Aryans came down here, but they were absorbed into our language and our culture. So you should start speaking Hindi and you should start going to the temples. That's what we should have told them.
By their definition, they were already Aryans, because English and Hindi are equally Aryans. So that point really.
Exactly. There's a super chat here from Vootla Chaitanya. Thank you for the super chat, Chaitanya. He's wondering if you've heard about this. He's saying that I've heard that Sanjay ji and others have put out a challenge with a 15 lakh prize for proving Aryan invasion theory to be correct, and it's being held at some literature fest. Is this true? Has anyone accepted the challenge? Do you know anything about this?
No, I have no idea.
Yeah, I don't think I've heard anything about this as well, Chaitanya.
Yeah.
But anyway, so the book, guys, is called Genetics and the Aryan Debate, Early Indians, Tony Joseph's Latest Assault. It's available on Amazon to buy. It's available. I think it's available in bookstores as well now.
I have no idea.
Okay. So at least...
Voice of India books are generally available in bookstores. You have to get them from the publisher himself.
That's true. So it's available on Amazon for sure. So I have provided the link in the description, guys. Check it out. In my opinion, in my humble opinion, I think it has the most cogent article, you know, that sort of brings the peace between this migration element and the OIT element. I think it's the most cogent and the most well thought out argument. So I really, really recommend that you guys check the book out. And Shrikantji, you're having a book launch as well very soon, right? Do you want to tell us a little bit about that? So if there's some people in Mumbai, they can go and attend.
It's on Saturday at Andheri, the recreation club near Andheri Recreation Club near Bowens College. From 3 to 6.
Okay. And are there going to be other speakers?
G.D. Bakshi's book also, Major General G.D. Bakshi's book on the Saraswati is also being released along with mine. Both the books are being released together by Vivek Agnihotri, you know, who produced this Tashkent Files recently.
Yes. Yeah, fantastic. So it's going to be a good event, guys. Make sure to go and check it out if you are in Mumbai on Saturday. It's on Saturday, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
I have one last question for you, Shrikantji, it's from the audience as well. And it's from Right is Always Right. He's contributed via Super Chat, so thank you for that. He's asking, please suggest a few books, on Dharma or any books that Shrikantji can suggest that people should read. Apart from the new one that you've come out with, of course. So start with that one.
No, my book is not on Dharma, actually. It is on history.
I think it still goes a long way.
Though people ask me, what is the spiritual content of your books? So I said, it doesn't really have spiritual content. It's a historical book.
Yes.
Yeah, it's about history.
So let me change the question a little bit then. What are some of the books that you should recommend that people read?
Well, on what topic? History, you mean?
On history, well, I would culture, recommend whatever you like to read.
I think if whatever work they're doing in culture, you know, like as I said, India has a very rich variety of everything, all aspects of culture. So I think everyone should try to this thing, you know, culture just doesn't mean politically fighting out for Indian this thing. Actually go into the thing, music, architecture, and try to, all those who are doing work in that field are, you know, really doing something good.
Yeah.
Read all those books, learn what you can about Indian music, Indian architecture, Indian history, Indian, everything Indian.
That
will be quite sufficient.
All right.
And
fantastic.
There are thousands of books. I don't know what I can recommend on that.
No, that's fair enough. Fair enough. Okay. Well, Shrikantji, again, thank you very much for coming on the show today. Thank you very much for helping, shed a little more light and a little more clarity on this whole debate issue. I got a chance to read your book and I really enjoyed it, and I would really recommend everybody else who's watching to go check out the book as well. The link is again in the description of this video. Again, thank you very much for Srikanthji for coming on the show. It was a real pleasure.
Thank you.
All right, guys, if you enjoyed today's video, please make sure to leave a like, leave a thumbs up, subscribe if you haven't already, if you're watching for the first time. I will see you guys next time. And if you're in Mumbai for the event, please go check it out and go say hi to Srikanthji as well. I will see you guys next time. And until then, stay happy, stay healthy.